So the webinar is live now. Over to you, Samiksha.
We've just broadcasted the webinar. We will wait for a couple of minutes for all the participants to join in. Meanwhile, I request all the joint participants to take the pre-poll that we just launched. I can see the number of participants increasing in the room. I think we can start the webinar now. I am Dr. Samiksha Saxena Lamba from Medical Learning Hub. Today, we all welcome you to a live webinar on COVID variants, vaccination and treatment by API Gujarat. The event has been sponsored by Mylan Pharmaceuticals Private Limited, a Viatris company. So for today, our host panelists are Dr. Dhiren Patel, sir, who is the president of API Gujarat. He is a director and consultant physician at Sanjeevani Hospital ICCU Center, Surat, since the past 20 years. He is a member of various medical associations also, like National Ethics Committee, IMA, headquartered at Delhi, Hospital Board of India of Surat, IMA. And he's a secretary of North Gujarat Doctors Association, Gujarat, Surat, NGDA. And he's also been an ex-Senate member of Gujarat University of Ahmedabad and has received many awards and academically very prominent. The next host panelist for the day is Dr. Ketan Joshi, sir. He's a secretary, API Gujarat. He is an MD medicine consultant physician at SM Smith Medical and Heart Hospital, Visnagar, North Gujarat, and has been practicing for more than 25 years. He is the ex-president of NGPA. Now I would like to introduce our speakers for the day. The first speaker for the day will be Dr. Mahadev Desai, sir. He's a senior consultant physician and has completed his education from MS University, Vadodara. He served at various medical colleges of Gujarat, Surat and Ahmedabad. Is also affiliated to HCG Hospital, Ahmedabad, and has a teaching experience of more than 37 years and has been awarded at Dr. N.H. Patel and Dr. Rasiklal Shah Oration at APCON and in 2018 and Dr. B.N. Mehta Oration by AMA in 2012. The next speaker for the day is Dr. Bhagirath B. Solanki, sir. He's a professor and head of unit Department of Medicine, BJ Medical College. He's the president of APG. He was the president of APG 2015 and treasurer APG in 1921. He has a teaching experience of more than 20 years. Has a various number of publications under his name, namely, like, you know, he's got 12 publications at national, international 6, and research projects under his name are 10. He's a member of various associations also, such as IMA, APG, API, CSI, and RSSDI. He has worked during epidemic disasters and actively participating in community programs and community television shows. The moderators for the day, we have Dr. Jitender Anand, sir, who is the Vice President, API Gujarat. He is MD, PhD, and practices at Anand Multispeciality Hospital. He is the principal and co-investigator in various clinical trials and has been is the Honorary Secretary at Association of Physicians, Ahmedabad. The next moderator for the day is Dr. Anil Kulshrestha, sir. He's the Secretary of Association of Physicians of Ahmedabad. He's a fellow Indian of Indian Academy of Clinical Medicine. He's has also been a part of various medical associations and as a senior consultant has been practicing for more than 33 years. We have Dr. Naim Kadri, ma'am, who is from BJ Medical College as a professor of medicine, as the observer for the day. I will just like to walk everyone through the structure of the webinar. We will have the welcome address in the first poll that we've already raised for all the participants. I hope everyone has taken them. Then we'll give the stage to Dr. Dhiren sir, the president of API Gujarat, to give us a welcome note. The session one will be taken by Dr. Desai on the topic, Desai sir, on the topic COVID variants and vaccines. The second topic of the day, that is treatment of COVID patients in a second wave, will be taken by Dr. Solanki sir. Will be followed by a question and answer session, which will be moderated by our moderators. And then the vote of thanks by Dr. Ketan Joshi sir, Secretary API Gujarat. And we will move forward to the poll, that is the end poll, during the webinar, and a vote of thanks by Medical Learning Hub. I would like to take you all through a few general instructions for all the participants. All the participants will be muted during the webinar. If you have any queries, please type in the Q&A section. All the questions will be answered at the end of the session and will be moderated by our moderators. If you have any comments, please type in the chat section. We will be recording this webinar and the recording will be available in the next 2 to 3 days. And an email notification will be sent to all the participants about the same. As I mentioned before, the poll will be raised at the end of the session for all the participants, and we request all the participants to provide their valuable feedback. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Mylan Pharmaceuticals Private Limited for supporting us in this series of webinar and making it a success. Mylan Pharmaceuticals Private Limited, a Viatris company, is one of the world's largest pharmaceutical company with a mission to provide 7 billion people the access to high quality medicine. With significant contributions in the battle against tuberculosis, HIV and hepatitis across the globe, Mylan is again at the forefront to fight COVID-19 with its care portfolio comprising of remdesivir and favipiravir. I would also like to introduce Panacea. It is a patient portal which helps the COVID-19 patients in their rehabilitation. The program is helping to boost immunity, mental strength, and a good diet. To know about this and to register yourself and the patients, please visit the given link. Thank you so much. I would like to now give the stage to Dr. Dhiren Patel, sir, to tell us about, give us some insights about COVID-19 and how API Gujarat has been a part of it in handling it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Samisa, for wonderful introduction of all panelists. With this, good morning. Respected seniors, my physicians, colleagues, and all attendees of APG, API Gujarat, I heartily welcome all of you and thanks for attending this CME, such an informative CME, because COVID-19 pandemic since March 2020 in India is a very deadly disease and it caused number of deaths. We cannot count, and it's very sad part for physicians, those who are treating themselves involved, you know, for such a miserable condition, and ultimately we lost many members of our physicians. So really very sad for this COVID pandemic disease. Every time we are learning new things. Since this disease started, this pandemic, every time the new protocols coming, new drugs coming, and the strain every time is changing, and we don't know the exactly really what is the treatment and what should be the real controllable measure to control this disease, deadly disease. Actually, this time the second wave, very dangerous for all of us, and we have seen number of deaths. So it is right time to know about the right treatment to treat this disease. And for this, API is always, API Gujarat is always doing such a nice academic event all the times. Even we did in mid-APGCon with that, Dr. Guleria, AIIMS director, Dr. Rivari sir and Dr. Dhruv, they are, you know, stalwart about the disease, treating the disease. And they were, you know, given excellent guidance in MedAPGCon. And this time also, we have stalwart and, you know, our teacher, Dr. Mahadev sir, he's really thorough gentleman and such a nice person and great academician. And his knowledge, not about the disease, but everything about the all medicine problem. We have learned so many things, even all physicians from Gujarat, you know, Mahadev sir is our teacher for all. So we have today, we are getting insight about the disease of this COVID variants and vaccine about from Dr. Mahadev sir. And another speaker, Dr. Bhagirath sir, he's also very academician and very knowledgeable person and HOD of this BJ Medical College. He's giving insight and the information about the treatment of this second wave of this COVID-19 pandemic. Really, every time we know this is a drug, and every time, like after 1 month or something time, after 15, 20 days or whatever time, the treatment protocol change. Even for, you know, the CDC guidelines from USA, they are declared. And after sometimes we come to know exactly new drug, new therapy, new treatment. Actually, it is very difficult to treat this disease. So that's why we have to arrange such nice of CME. And I'm thankful to Mylan Pharmaceutical for arranging the second CME for API Gujarat, right? And with this, I also thanks to our moderator, Dr. Anil Bhai Kulshrestha. He's a scientific chairman and past president of API Gujarat. And Dr. J.S. Anand, sir, he's also incoming president of API. And I also thanks to Vibrant Secretary, our Dr. Ketan Joshi. And with this, I invite Dr. Mahadev sir for lecture. But before that, I hand over to this Dr. Anil Kulshrestha and Dr. J.S. Anand as a moderator. Thank you all. And please take care yourself and your family, please.
Thank you, Dr. Dhiren Bhai and other panelists. Good, very good morning to all of you. Now, without wasting time, we hand over mic to Dr. Mahadev Desai to start his presentation, which I think is really very, very useful. SARS-CoV-2 variants and vaccination. Vaccination is the biggest issue right now. Everybody is rushing for vaccination. When there was a time, government was insisting, people were not taking it. But time teaches us everything, with so much of morbidity and mortality all around us. So we need vaccine. That now I think this reality has sunk in the minds of everybody. Dr. Mahadev Desai, please start your presentation.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So thank you very much, Dr. Dhiren Patel and all the office bearers of API and APG, Dr. Dhiren, Dr. Anil Kulshrestha, Dr. Jitendra Anand, and also to my fellow colleague, Dr. Bhagirath Solanki and Dr. Naim Kadri as an observer of Gujarat Medical Council. Before I begin, let me say that we must pay homage to all our colleagues, all healthcare workers who have lost their lives fighting against the corona, and we pay condolences to all their family members. You can see that there's a change in the title. I have given the title SARS-CoV-2 variant because variant name should go with the virus and not with the disease. COVID-19 is a disease while SARS-CoV-2 is a variant. So that is what I'm going to talk about. The outline of my talk, I'll be talking about what are the variants, what is the difference between the mutation, variants and strains, what is the impact of variants, and what is the difference between efficacy and effectiveness and vaccinations and breakthrough infections. We know that most of our patients and their relatives now are there almost, you can say virologist or COVIDologist, and we need to know everything about the corona structure as well as the disease and the drugs, including the latest thing that has appeared today because of the social media and the WhatsApp University. We have got so many doctorates and PhD in our patients community. So we need to know and we have to be little up. So I'm trying to give few things which probably our patients would not be knowing. So let's begin. So first is the SARS-CoV-2 structure. This is very important to know because unless we know the structure, we will not know about the mutations and the variants and the strains. So we all know that SARS-CoV-2 is belonging to the corona family, and there is, it's a single-stranded RNA molecule where the special part is the spike protein, the major envelope glycoprotein, which is expressed on the surface. And this is the main target of the vaccines, because this is the one protein which gets embedded to the host ACE2 receptors. This SARS-S protein or spike protein is made up of two subunits. If you enlarge these, there are two subunits. One is called S1 and the second is S2. This S1 is called the receptor binding domain. So this is the one which first gets attached to the ACE2 receptors. So any changes in this structure would make the virus behave differently. That's why it is very important to understand then, before we understand the variants and the mutations. So S1 and S2 region are the proteins of the spike protein subunits, wherein any changes may bring about the different behavior of the viruses. And as we have seen, as early as September 2020, then Europe first reported one particular mutations. The mutations keep changing, keep coming, but the one particular mutation, what they name as N501Y. N501Y, these are the numbers, figures are the position of the particular amino acid. And first number is the N, which is the aspargine, which is replaced by tyrosine, which is given as Y. So why I'm giving you this, this people will be knowing about this. So we should know what does this number mean. And the very group of these viruses which have this particular mutation, they are called B117. So B117 is considered as an UK strain. And as I said, the N is replaced by tyrosine or Y. So first thing, what is the difference between a mutation, variant, and strain? As we know that virus keep on replicating and duplicating, and during the process of duplications, there are errors. These errors lead to mutation. So mutations are the ones which are the defective or incomplete, or the different types of RNA protein sequences. So mutations produce the similar but not exact copies. So the virus structures look almost same, but they are not exact copies. And any viruses that contains the mutations are called variants. So mutations are the difference in the virus structures. And any virus this has got mutations are called the variants. You can see that here the RNA has elongated, and that becomes a variant. Whenever the variant behave differently, it is called a strain. So any variant will behave different than the original parent structures. The first one, as we said, is a Wuhan SARS-CoV-2, right? It was Wuhan origin. Now, if it changes the characteristics of its proteins because of the mutations, it becomes a variant. And any variant behave differently is called a strain. The variant is also called lineage or lineage. Some structures use the word lineage. So a strain is the one which behave differently. Either it becomes more or less infectious. It can cause more severe disease. It can affect different age group. It can escape the immune recognition, and that is why it makes the vaccine ineffective. Or even it can escape the immune recognition in such a way that the persons who had previous COVID infections can also become now vulnerable to the next infection. So that's the difference between mutation, variant, and strain. Mutation is the defective RNA chains. Variant is the one which contains these mutations, and a strain is a one variant which behaves differently. So the important thing is all strains are variants. All strains are variants, but all variants are not strains. We have got so many variants, but all variants are not strains. The international nomenclature for this is VUI, which is a variant under investigations. Whenever there are different, the virology units would always keep on surveilling the different kinds of the samples from the patients who had suffered from the corona infections, and they would find out whether there is any change in their molecular structures and the sequence of the amino acids. So if you find some differences, they'll put it as variant under investigations or VUI. And whenever it occurs in a larger number in a smaller areas or behave differently, they call it variant of interest, one particular one which is going around in India, in Andhra Pradesh, is called N440K. But when the variant becomes important, because it affects the diagnosis, because the variant may lead to escape of the diagnosis, that means it may not be picked up by the RT-PCR test that we do. If there is a change in the spike protein, and as we know that one of the gene that we pick up in the RT-PCR is the S gene. So that was the first time that people started looking for the different strain based on that the S gene was absent, even though the N and the M, the E genes are present in a particular specimen. That gives an indication that probably we are dealing with a different strain. The variant of high consequences is one which leads to the total failure of the diagnosis. We can't pick up the particular strain because it just cannot be picked up by the routine RT-PCR, or it makes the vaccine ineffective, or there may be high vaccine breakthrough cases, or it makes the most of the drugs ineffective. Fortunately, there is no variant of high consequence as of now. So right now we have got many variants of concern, and this is one of the important slide to give the different types of variants that are prevalent, variants of concern. As I said, the first one is a UK strain, which was picked up first in UK in September 2020. And USA in the January month of 2021. It is given the name B117, and the mutations, the most important mutations, is N5015. In fact, there are more than 23 mutations in UK strain, but the one which are important, which leads to the different behavior, is N5015. And the significance of this strain is that it led to increased transmissibility by the factor of 70%. Or it changed the R0, or what is called the doubling rate of the virus infections, how many times it infects the other people. So that was the first strain, UK strain B117. Then came the Brazil strain. It was given the name P1. There, over and above N501Y, the new mutation was picked up, that is E484K. This is very important to remember. Easy to remember that whenever there is an E 484K, it escapes the immune recognition by the body. That is why it leads to some problem of the efficacy of the people who are already vaccinated. There are also 35 mutations all in all, but the important one was E484K. Then came South African strain. This was picked up somewhere in the October. It's given the name B15351. And here there was another addition of the mutation at the receptor binding domains, that is K4179. And it also led to the increased transmissibility as well as immune response, immune escape. Now talking about the Indian variants, which we all know and which most of our patients and the relatives know, is B1617. This is also called double mutant. The double mutant is not the right word, because there are not only two mutants, there are more than 13 mutations in the viral structures, out of which 7 are in the spike protein domain itself. But the two important ones are the E484Q and L452R. This A484Q is resembling E484K, and L452R is the one which was the replica of one which was found in California. So only thing is, interesting part is, these two different mutations occur in a single particular virus structure, and that is why it's called double mutant. In fact, it's not a double mutant, but two different pathogenic mutants are present in one, and this had led to increased transmissibility, immune escape, and it is presumed that it is probably more lethal, looking at the number of people that were dying. But it's questionable, it's not pure, because we are not testing enough number of the specimens to say that these are the ones which lead to increased death. Probably it is the increased number of cases here, increased number of cases, that has led to the more deaths. Then there is a triple mutant, what is going on in the Mumbai, some of the specimens found. It's a particular V382L, but again, neither triple mutant or the V1, which is the AP variant, N440K, are considered as variant of concerns by the international authorities. So only thing we are worried right now is the B1617. The Indian variant is picked up by the group of the body called the Indian SARS-CoV-2 Consortium of Genomics or INSA-COGI. This is the one which is established by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare Department in December 2020, and it carries out in its 10 different laboratories across the state, across the country, the different genome sequences and analyzing. And they picked up as early as the January, between January and March, they picked up 220 out of 361 samples had this particular variant picked up. And it has been said at that point of time that almost 20% of the samples they analyzed that contained this double mutant. But now it is said that almost 40% of the samples, the number keep on increasing as they keep on sequencing many more samples, that almost 40% of the samples in the Maharashtra is considered to be this B.1.1.6.7. And it has already traveled across India and it is picked up in 21 countries. Well, that's one of the reasons that that international travel ban has come in force for last few days. And the AP variant is a new kid in the block. Now coming to the present wave or the second wave and the effect of vaccinations, we knew that the first case appeared as early as 27th January 2020 in Kerala in India. The first case appeared in the last week of December in Wuhan in China, internationally, but India it came on the 27th January, and this case started increasing very gradually. And first wave, we consider as wave because it peaked somewhere in the September 2020. But at that time also, the daily number of cases had not crossed 1 lakh. It's very, very important to know these figures because we know now what we are dealing with. So in the September 2020, at the peak of the wave, also there were not more than 1 lakh cases registered daily. While the second peak and almost in the 25th January, at the 7-day average was only around 14,000 cases. And all of us started that probably we are into the finishing or the end game of the COVID pandemic, but that was not to be the case. And come March, and we have started showing the increased cases. And this is the second wave. In the second wave, the cases keep on increasing. And now we hear almost 400,000 cases, new cases daily. That is 4 lakh cases are occurring daily. And the second part is the projection part. We wish that is how it turns around because the actual data is only up to here. This is the mathematical model. And it's presumed that by the end of this month or maybe in the 15 days in the June, we'll be coming on the downslope and maybe the end of the second wave. But as of now, on the 8th, that is before the day, the average daily case were around 4 lakhs and the deaths were around 4,000. We have 37 lakhs active cases as on now, and we have recovered cases of 1 crore and 82. The deaths are around 2.41 lakhs. And if you see the map of India, that almost everywhere we have got the cases. Coming to the second part is the breakthrough infections or the infections occurring in the patients who already have been vaccinated. If you go by the CDC definitions, the CDC definition is the breakthrough infection is one where the person has already received the primary series of US FDA COVID vaccine. And after 14 days of the second dose, if a person develops the RT-PCR positive or rapid antigen positive for SARS-CoV-2, then it is considered as the breakthrough infection. And in CDC website, as on 26th of April, there were more than 95 million persons have been vaccinated, and out of which the 9245 cases have occurred, out of which people more than 60 were 45 persons. There were 27 persons were asymptomatic, and there were 9% hospitalizations. In this, out of 835, there must about 200 patients or about 2% were the one which had positive, but they were asymptomatic. And there were 1% death, but out of 132 also, almost about 20% of the death were not related to the COVID. But we can say that about 1% death can occur even amongst the patients who are fully vaccinated. There was another study which appeared in the Lancet before 2 days, which is called a Siren study. This is the study of the Pfizer vaccines in England. Here, the SARS-CoV immunity and reinfection evaluation study, about 23,000 patients or the healthcare workers were studied, and they found that the vaccine effectiveness was 70% after 21 days of the first dose and 85% of the 7 days after the second dose. And what they found out that the persons who were vaccinated, 40% only reported the typical symptoms as against 63% who were unvaccinated. So we may not get the typical symptoms of the SARS-CoV infections if you are vaccinated. A point that is to be kept in mind, and persons may remain asymptomatic and can still transmit a disease, something that we need to keep in mind for all those who are vaccinated. The ICMR data says that in India, the breakthrough infection is only between 2 and 4 per 10,000, but these are the figures that the ICMR has really derived from the official persons who have given their intimations about their infections occurring after the vaccinations. So probably it is a gross underrepresentation of the actual case of the breakthrough infections after vaccinations, because many of the asymptomatic infections would obviously not be reported. Plus many of the infections persons, if they do not fill up the form at the time of giving the RT-PCR, will not go to the registry. So it's not a question of the wrong figure, but really it is an underrepresentation because of the errors on the part of the persons who are supposed to report. If you see the number of persons who have been vaccinated and who have the COVID infections recorded, we can say that as of last week, the Covaxin has been given to 1.1 crore people and Covishield has been given to 11.6. Now the actual figure of total vaccination is crossed 15% of the 15 crores. So out of the first dose, about 4,000 cases of Covaxin vaccinated and 17,000 of the Covishield vaccination have developed the infections. And after second dose, it comes to 0.006% or 0.004% of the Covaxin and Covishield vaccines. So we can say that the vaccines have definitely prevented the infections in large number of the people, and vaccines have at all caused the infections, that infections remain mild or asymptomatic. And again, there was one study from the 40s, which Fortis Research Institute in May 3 publications in the Diabetes and Metabolic Syndrome Clinical Research and Review Studies, where 123 doctors, paramedical persons, and maintenance staff of the Fortis hospitals have been included, out of which 113, the number is less, but at least it gives the idea about the real world scenario. There, the Covishield was given in 85 participants and 28 in the were given a Covaxin. Out of 113, 18 persons developed the infections. That comes to 16 persons. So that exactly was my point. The number of infections, the breakthrough infections, could be close to around anything from 10 to 16 persons, as we also see in our clinical practice. The good part is the hospitalization is still very less, but of late we have started seeing even the patients do die after the two dose of vaccinations. Maybe the studies in the clinical trials and in the real world scenario are different, that we deal with the people who are already having the comorbid conditions and many other factors. So infections after vaccinations, as the Dr. Anthony Fauci, who is the chief experts of the CDC, has also said that the B1.1.6.7 variant is also responding to the Covaxins. And in India, Covaxin and Covishield, both vaccines have shown marked reduction in the cases, severity of the infections also reduced, and the hospitalizations and deaths have also remarkably reduced. We have got one more study from our healthcare persons, that is in the 552 Indian healthcare workers who have undergone this analysis of the humoral antibody response after either Covishield or Covaxin. This is called a COVID study. It's an ongoing study, and they collect the blood for the antibodies. And after the first dose of 552, the persons, after 21 days, they have analyzed and they have found that both of these groups, whether you have Covishield or Covaxin, have anti-spike antibodies. There are independent predictors of the antibody response, whether the persons had past COVID infections or presence of comorbid or the which vaccine has been received. There are, but we can know about this in detail only after the second dose response of the antibody response. But it's an ongoing study, and the good part is that it shows that there is a good humoral antibody response. I would go a step ahead. Even if there is no humoral antibody response in the persons who have received vaccines, we know that these vaccines work by B cell as well as T cell mediated antibodies. So T cell mediated response, we may not be able to know clinically because we don't have that measure available in the laboratories, but most of the persons will also have T cell response. And that is the reason even in the persons who have a very poor antibody response do not catch the infections. Now that comes to the question of what is the difference between efficacy and effectiveness. Most of the people use this term interchangeably, but that's not the case. Efficacy is something which is the percentage of vaccinated people in whom the disease is prevented as compared to the control population who are not given the vaccines in a clinical trial. So efficacy is something related to the trial in which one group of persons are given the vaccines, the other persons are not given the vaccines, and at the end of trial or they decide a particular number of cases that when they are present, they will analyze the studies and they will find out that how many persons in the vaccinated group and how many persons in the unvaccinated or the placebo arm developed the infections or the test was positive. That's called the efficacy. And once we know that most of the vaccines have anything from 70 to 95% of the efficacy, but the same efficacy is not translated into the real world effectiveness. So effectiveness of a vaccine is the percentage of vaccinated people in general population. It's a general populations in the real world scenario where they are compared with the persons who are not vaccinated, right? So efficacy is something related to clinical trial, where effectiveness is a real world data. Efficacy may be 70%, 80%, but the effectiveness, even if it is 50%, we should be more than happy. And that is what we have been happy with most of our influenza vaccine for last 10 years. They are not more than 50%, but at 50% bring about the herd immunity. The number of cases as well as the vaccinations will bring about the herd immunity, and that will save our day and reduce the mortality. So if I talk of my personal experience, just before 20 days, all my family of 6 members suffered from the infections. We are 6, out of which 2 are children, 1 is 6 years and another 1.5 years, all had fever, 4 had other symptoms also, and all of us presented like the sinusitis infections. Up till now, we are thinking that the running nose or the nasal discharge or sneezing are not the symptoms of SARS infections or the corona infections. It is more related to the influenza or influenza-like illness, but all of us had severe headache, running nose, sneezing. But luckily after 3 days, all our fever and the symptoms start abating. We also had loss of smell and taste, and 4 of us tested positive. 1 was negative probably because the person was tested because the person has come for collecting the samples and at the time no symptoms. But all had mild symptoms, and the all inflammatory markers done only once showed mild rise in CRP and D-dimer. We did not test for the second time. We did not go for the HRCT. We received only paracetamol. Only one of our family member who had a little more symptoms and vaccine only for the once had been given the budesonide inhalers, because by the time the report started coming in that budesonide inhalers are working. But honestly submitting, we have not received any doxycycline, ivermectin or favipiravir. We just are cured by only symptomatic treatment and hydrations, and we are back to work after 14 days. So we expect that the flattening of the curve as predicted and hopefully downsloping also start in the end of the May, but there is a danger for the third wave. As we have been listening to Professor K. Vijay Raghavan, is the principal scientific advisor to the government of India. He said that we should be prepared for the third wave in the near future, probably in the month of July or August. Their presumption is that most of the people who have suffered from it or are vaccinated 6 months, if they pass, the antibodies levels will go down. And we also have the another and the populations who are vulnerable. So unless we have a vaccination drive on a war footing, we are into the third wave, and this third wave, as per the projections, may affect the children more. And this time also we have seen, as compared to the first wave, the children are not only affected, they are symptomatic, they are admitted, and we have lost even few children also. So we have got to be prepared for the third wave. And what is important for all this is we have to stick to our COVID appropriate behavior. So what is COVID appropriate behavior is what we used to call SMS. And after the vaccines came, our good friend Dr. Petrolala added the word V. So now we call it SMSV. So SMSV is the social distancing of minimum 6 feet, the mask, not only mask, but that the chief says the double mask. When we come out or when we see our patients, we must use double mask. The inner one has to be the medical mask or the triple layer mask or the N95. The outer one may be the cloth covered. We must sanitize. Even if there are studies that probably the fomites do not play a significant role, but when we are working in an atmosphere, when the aerosols keep bringing out the SARS coronaviruses, it's better that we do not do away with the sanitizations and vaccine at the first available opportunity. One in all around us must be vaccinated. Even if they do not show the effectiveness of to the tune of 70-90%, it will make at least most of us safe to the tune of not going to the hospitalizations, and we will not add to the need for the oxygen beds and the ventilator beds, which is very, very important. Even if we reduce the number of hospitalizations and the number of need for oxygen and the ventilations, we have done our job. We know about this COVID appropriate behavior, but our giant Gulzar has rightly said and predicted long back that we must do the COVID appropriate behavior. He came out beautiful lines. बेवजह घर से निकलने की जरूरत क्या है, बेवजह घर से निकलने की जरूरत क्या है, मौत से आंख मिलाने की जरूरत क्या है, मौत से आंख मिलाने की जरूरत क्या है. एंड ही राइटली सेड दैट द कोरोना इज गोइंग टू बी एरोसोल्स. सो नाउ वी नो दैट लैंसेट हैज क्लियर्ड एंड देयर आर मोर देन 10 रीजंस टू से दैट इट्स नॉट ओनली अ ड्रॉपलेट इन्फेक्शंस बट द एरोसोल्स एंड द ड्रॉप्स आल्सो प्रोड्यूस द इन्फेक्शंस. सो ही सेड that सबको मालूम है बाहर की हवा है कातिल, सबको मालूम है बाहर की हवा है कातिल, फिर कातिल से उलझने की जरूरत क्या है, right? So with this, I must say, we must remain स्वस्थ रहो, व्यस्त रहो. We have to maintain our livelihood. So we don't say that we remain, but so those who have not to go out, we must keep in this mind. So व्यस्त रहो, स्वस्थ रहो, व्यस्त रहो, घर में भी रहो तो मस्त रहो. Thank you all for patient listening. Hand over to the moderators and for the subsequent question answer session. Thank you all for listening. I'm very happy to say that there are more than 400 persons attending, and if we can be of any use, it made our day. Thank you all.
Mahadev bhai, as usual, it was wonderful to hear to you. It was very, very informative. It cleared a lot of doubts, and especially you have touched the basic science about the vaccine. So that was very important. As a physician, we don't know much about the basic science. So you have not even left basic science. Great, sir. Salute to you as usual. It was a wonderful presentation. Question answer we will be taking after the lecture of Dr. Bhagirath Bhai. I think that will be appropriate. So I will request my co-panelist, Dr. Anand sir, to call on Dr. Bhagirath Solanki to start his presentation.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everybody. Now I would like to invite Dr. Bhagirath Solanki, sir. He is a senior professor working at BJ Medical College and Civil Hospital to deliver his talk, COVID-19 management in second wave. Bhagirath, sir, please.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. Thank you, Association of Physicians of Gujarat, the President, Dr. Dhiren Patel, Secretary, Dr. Ketan Joshi, our moderator, Dr. Anil Kulshrestha, and Dr. J.S. Anand, and my co-speaker, previous speaker, senior Dr. Madhav Desai, and GMC observer, Dr. Naimben Kadare. I will talk about the COVID-19 management in the second wave. My flow of event would be like this. We'll be briefly touching the epidemiology, viral structure. Dr. Desai sir have already talked in detail about the spike protein and all. Very briefly, symptoms and sign investigation, and then we'll more focus on various treatment modalities, oxygen, and lastly, the Indian guidelines. This is the COVID virus structure, which is having an M protein, an envelope E protein, and spike protein S, and a membrane nucleoprotein, which is N. And this is a single-stranded RNA. So it is an RNA virus. This kind of coronavirus have earlier created havoc in the world in certain geographical areas as a SARS in the first decades of the 21st century. And in the second decade earlier part, it came as a MERS. But these COVID virus now, which we are handling in the end of the second decade of the 21st century, is the COVID-19. And the disease caused by this SARS coronavirus 2 is COVID-19. We have seen the many number of cases all over the world. In the previous lecture, Dr. Madhav sir showed us the graph of the Indian statistics. Currently, we have around 2.118 crore of patients and till yesterday, and around 2.3 lakh or something, a big number of deaths. The incubation period is 2 to 14 days, but the median period is 4 to 5 days only. One study have reported that 7.5% of the people with COVID-19 who have symptoms will do so within 11.5 days of SARS-CoV coronavirus infection. And that makes a sense of 14 days of quarantine, which we are practicing since the beginning of this pandemic. The symptoms, we all know, everybody know, the symptoms can be of a throat pain, fever, malaise, and all. Some GI symptoms also we have reported, vomiting, diarrhea. And then the patient will have a shortness of breath, their profound weakness. That is the fundamental presenting symptoms, but some atypical symptoms are also reported, in which most important that we have seen that hyperglycemic and diabetic ketoacidosis. Then we have cerebrovascular accident, myocarditis in case of heart, coronary artery disease, cardiogenic shock, and DVT, pulmonary embolism, and catheter related thrombosis, and some COVID toes kind of things, which are called as urticarial rash, petechy, or purpura. What has been new is the dermatological manifestations, what I referred to as some pinkish or purplish coloration in the toes, or a kind of a typical microcirculatory blocks causing the gangrenous changes and which causes the COVID toes. There is considered to be a prolonged shedding of replication competent COVID virus in the severely immunocompromised patients. Then reports of reinfection to the persons who have been previously infected with the variant virus. Post-vaccine infection is beautifully explained by the Dr. Madhav Desai sir. And now there is a threat in the second wave in the last few weeks, and particularly last week, is the increasing number of the mucormycosis patients. Now we'll touch upon the treatment part, which will be in the various subtitles: antivirals, anti-inflammatory, anticoagulants, immunomodulators, antimicrobials, oxygen, non-invasive and invasive ventilations, and others. Now, typically, this is from the beginning of the pandemic. We see that the first week or first 5-7 days, there is a virus enters, replicate in the host, and increase the viremia. But the native or innate immunity is going to curtail the virus and reduce the viral replication and reduce the viral load, and that is how the affected organs are safeguarded or probably saved. But we have seen that in the beginning of the, in the end of the first week or beginning of the second week, between 7 to 9 days period of time, the cytokine release syndrome. Cytokine release syndrome, the cytokines are created by the human immune system to fight against the virus, to contain the virus in the tissues or organs where it has entered. But when virus is more in number or probably more virulent, it is not able to contain by the cytokines, and the cytokine keep on mounting to the extent that increased number of cytokines and increased cytokines are going to be threatening to the various organs of the body. And that is the host, the inflammatory response, which we call it cytokine storm or cytokine release syndrome. So logically thinking, the antiviral should be there as early as possible in the first week. But when we go to the end of the first week or beginning of the second week, it should be antiviral, anti-inflammatory, anticoagulant, maybe convalescent plasma, corticosteroids and anticoagulants, and the immunomodulators should be the treatment of choice in the latter part of the first week to beginning of the second week. This is what we have understood since the last year. Now, antivirals, these are different because viruses are different from other microbes because they do not stay in the environment for long period without a host. They always require a host. They replicate intracellularly. They use the host metabolic machinery. So it is difficult to kill because moment we try to kill, we will damage the cell. So depending on the area of involvement, the cellular damage is also possible theoretically with the antivirals. Now, antivirals which are used in the COVID-19 are remdesivir, favipiravir, lopinavir, ritonavir, and now very recently pegylated interferon alpha 2b is also on cards in the phase 2 trials or maybe early phase 3 trial. Convalescent plasma considered to be a neutralizing to the virus, but will take in the modulate immunomodulators. Remdesivir, we have seen that remdesivir dose, everybody know in the second wave, the last 1 month, there is a lot of shortage about the remdesivir. Everyone know about the doses also. But what is the evidence to that? The remdesivir mechanism of action is RNA dependent, RNA polymerase. And because of that, it interferes with the viral replication. So it is, should be considered as a true antiviral. It was actually used in Hep C, respiratory syncytial virus, Ebola virus, MERS and SARS virus. It has been tried. That is how this has been also thought that probably it will work, and it preliminary report says that it was working in small studies. So in NEJM 8 October 2020 study, this preliminary result was there in May 2020, shows that it was tried in 1062 patients. Remdesivir arm was 541 patients, placebo arm was 521 patients. But at the end of the study, it was found that median recovery time was 10 days in remdesivir arm, 15 days in the placebo arm. There was no significant benefit in terms of mortality, in terms of oxygen requirement, in terms of NIV, or in terms of IMV. So this is the 8 October 2020 NEJM report, which says the side effects of remdesivir, that it can cause serious nephrotoxicity. It is because of the beta-cyclodextrin. This is less in the lyophilized powder form of 3 grams of per 100 ml, 100 milligram. While in case of a solution, when it is available as a ready-made solution which is sold, then it is a 6 grams, double. So it makes a sense if the remdesivir is we use, then lyophilized powder would be better in the patients who are likely to have a compromised renal functions. Now come to the favipiravir. Favipiravir again is approved by DCGI on 9 June 2020. It's under emergency medical use on a fast track approval. it again interfere with the viral replication of RNA, this influenza viruses, and that is how it makes the virus non-replicating. This molecule was developed by Japan. It is a repurposed drug, and we know that Japan molecule sometime in diabetes, probably we are using the DPP-4 inhibitor, that is a Japan molecule, although it doesn't have the much the evidence as the international scientific community, but we are using it. The controversy about the favipiravir is there that it was tested for a primary endpoint of RT-PCR negative in placebo arm versus the favipiravir arm, but it was not statistically significant. But somehow secondary endpoint in terms of resolution of fever and resolution of symptoms, it was found to be significant. Now the controversy is ongoing because FDA somewhere in 2017 have taken a decision, the molecule which are under the clinical trial, when they are not able to fulfill the primary endpoint, one should not go with the secondary endpoint. So favipiravir is a drug where primary endpoint was not fulfilled, but the secondary endpoint is fulfilled, and based on that, it is being used in the COVID-19. The dose, all of us know, so no need to repeat. The side effects, common side effects are gastrointestinal because it's a number of pills are more like you have handful of pills you have to swallow morning and evening. Now 400 milligram pills are available. That has reduced the pill burden, but it is causing the uric acid elevation. So we should be careful in using the patients with the gout. It can adversely affect the neutrophil count. It can impair the liver function. It may have some psychiatric issues, and it can increase the blood triglycerides. The serious side effects was very low. And just to remember that it is teratogenic, so not to be used in the pregnant and potentially pregnant women. What is the evidence? That International Journal of Infectious Diseases, January 2021, where Shashank Joshi and his team, what he has found is that the evidence is not still a foolproof because there are 3 Indian study and total 27 randomized controlled trials are ongoing as far as the favipiravir is concerned. Once the results are out, we will come to know whether we should use with the confidence as a target drug which can definitely affect the COVID-19 infection. Now comes to the HCQS. Again, it is also causing the virus replication interference and causing the virus to be contained. But HCQS is considered in the last 1 year, if you see, then it has gone like a hype versus hope, because HCQS rather was floated more by the political and administrative community than the scientific community. The scientific evidence of late recently came was not in favor because of the various side effects that it causes: QT prolongation, it causes hemolytic anemia in this 6-PD deficient patient. It has a potential to cause hypoglycemia, retinal side effects, bone marrow side effects, dermatological side effects, and hepatotoxicity. Because of these 2 side effects, it has been said, it has been decided that it cannot be used in an unsupervised setting because this can be a serious side effect, particularly when it is combined with another drug which can increase the QT prolongation, that is azithromycin. Ivermectin is an antiparasitic drug which is used for the onchocerciasis, strongyloidiasis, and as a local topical application for scabies and head lice also. Ivermectin is also under clinical trial for malaria transmission because persons or livestock who has been fed with ivermectin, the mosquitoes are killed when they feed on these animals or the human beings who have been taking the ivermectin. So it may have a potential role in the prophylaxis of malaria in malaria endemic zones. But it inhibits the SARS-CoV in the cell cultures, but the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic dynamic studies suggest that what in vitro is required, it is 100 times more than in vivo, which we use as a therapeutic dose in human beings. So again, it is also interfering with the viral replication. It has side effects like dizziness, pruritus, nausea, diarrhea, and it has a neurological side effects in the, as an antiparasitic, but it is difficult to understand whether it is primarily because of the drug or primarily because of the parasitic disease. And definitely it has a teratogenic potential. Now we'll go to the anti-inflammatory there, which is defined here by the recovery trial, which set the board ruling for the anti-inflammatory as a proof for the management of the COVID infection. Recovery is a randomized evaluation of COVID-19 therapy in a United Kingdom. And this is all hospitals of NIH participated in. Till date, the trial has tested 10 interventions on adults, 8 repurposed drugs, and 1 newly developed drug and convalescent plasma. The New England Journal of Medicine in the very recently, 25 February 2021, have reported dexamethasone in hospitalized patients with COVID-19. It is a recovery collaborative group. This trial have randomized control open label adaptive platform, 176 hospital, 2:1 randomization, 2 for the standard of care, 1 for the intervention, that is the dexamethasone. Inclusion all COVID positive who have no contraindication to steroids more than 18 years of age. Age limit was removed on the May 2020. Pregnant and breastfeeding women who were candidate were also included. The study population have studied around more than 6,000 patients. Dexamethasone arm has a 1/3 patient, 2/3 patient is a usual care. 16% patient were on invasive mechanical ventilation or ECMO. Oxygen therapy were large number and not oxygen therapy were 24. What was the result? The result suggests that overall mortality was less with dexam. 28 days mortality on patient on invasive mechanical ventilation is also less compared to the usual care. And 28 days mortality in patient receiving oxygen without invasive mechanical means only a high flow, low flow oxygen is also having a significant improvement in dexam compared to the usual care. But the 28 days mortality in patient not receiving respiratory support, there the numbers are increased compared to the usual of care. Based on this result, it was advised in July 17, 2020 by NEJM article, and we have used since then dexamethasone as a potent drug in a patients who qualify for it. So what it concludes, patients hospitalized with COVID-19, the use of dexa resulted in a lower 28 days mortality among those who were receiving either invasive mechanical ventilation or oxygen alone at randomization, but not among those receiving the respiratory support. On the contrary, it may cause harm. We have seen the number increase. Now coming to the anticoagulant. Now, what is the rationale of using an anticoagulant? At increased risk of venous and arterial thrombosis in large or small vessels in the COVID-19, and the lab abnormalities which we have till date seen is mild thrombocytopenia, increased D-dimer, increase in FDPs, and prolonged prothrombin time. Elevated D-dimer level have been strongly associated with greater risk of death. So this results in a thrombotic complication, mostly DVT, deep venous thrombosis, and pulmonary embolism. Other reported manifestations are microvascular thrombi in the toes that cause COVID toes, clotting of intravascular catheters, ST ablation, myocardial infarction, and large vessel CV strokes. The pathogenesis for COVID-19 is multitude. It is incomplete understood, maybe because of hypoxia, high level of inflammatory cytokines, and activation of coagulation pathways. So anticoagulation used in COVID are LMWH, unfractionated heparin, indication is mild to moderate disease. The contraindication of active bleeding, severe thrombocytopenia, and in case of renal disease, LMWH. The postgraduate medical journal, April 13, 2021, the anticoagulation in COVID-19 current concepts and controversies have been reviewed. And what it suggests that presently all randomized controlled trials are ongoing. The guidelines published internationally until are based on consensus statements and experts' opinion only. And the dosing which they have reviewed is for the moderate disease, that is a standard risk patient, is prophylactic dose, that is enoxaparin 40 milligram once a day for a 70 kg adult who have a creatinine clearance more than 30 ml per minute. In a severe and critical disease, is considered as a high risk patient, which require intermediate dose, that is 40 milligram twice a day. Of course, in a patient who have creatinine clearance more than 30 kg. Those who have suspected to have the pulmonary embolism or DVT, it is a therapeutic dose, that is enoxaparin 1 milligram per kilogram every 12 hourly. The patients who have renal insufficiency, enoxaparin with dose reduction is the preferred over the other LMWH or can be used as a fondaparinux, or if it is not available, unfractionated heparin with APTT monitoring is indicated whenever eGFR is less than 15 ml per minute. Now coming to the anticoagulant as a post-discharge prophylactic. The same review article have suggested that post-discharge thromboprophylaxis is indicated in the modified improved VTE score, that is MIV score. Those who have more than 4 will show you in a minute, in a seconds about this score. And second category of patient, the MIV score more than 2 with a D-dimer value more than 2 times of upper limit of normal. These patients are given at least a 4 to 6 week of thromboprophylaxis oral. Now, what is this score? The scoring system goes like this. Previous VTE will have a 3 score. All the patients who are moderate and severe disease COVID-19 will be admitted having a 1 score. More than 60 years of age have 2 score. So a patient who is more than 60 years of age and admitted in ICU, he will have a 2 score. And in on a discharge, if his D-dimer is more than twice, he qualify for the thromboprophylaxis oral for the next 4 to 6 weeks. Second category, I think, will be a previous VTE, means those who have been reinfected. And if they have any evidence of during the previous COVID episode, any evidence of DVT or PE, they will carry the 3 score. So if they are admitted for the second time for moderate or severe, they will definitely qualify for the thromboprophylaxis. Now coming to the immunomodulators, these are convalescent plasma, tocilizumab, itolizumab, bevacizumab, and JAK inhibitors. Convalescent plasma is a concept which is the basic concept of from which the vaccination also came into the existence. We are using the anti-sera for the various diseases like diphtheria, tetanus, and snake venom. The immunoglobulins are also used in a post-exposure prophylaxis in Hep B and rabies, particularly in a hospital practice when a healthcare worker is having an accidental injury because of Hep B patient. We use the active and passive immunization. We use immunoglobulin. So the rationale is administration of plasma from the patients who have recovered from COVID-19. Of course, 28 days after the recovery, contain the antibodies, and these antibodies are going to neutralize the virus in the recipient, and that is how it is likely to reduce the disease progression. The dose is 14 to 13 ml per kg. 200 ml of single dose is infused over 2 hours, and it can be repeated in 24 hours. The contraindication is pregnant and breastfeeding women and known hypersensitivity to blood product. But what is the statement? Because ICMR also carried out in multicentric more than 39 centers about the plasma therapy, and that trial was named as PLACID trial, and the results came in the somewhere in the September, and the 23rd October BMJ, the editorial have said that the small beneficial effect were found for resolution of shortness of breath and fatigue. However, these results should be interpreted with caution because the trial was not blinded. So knowledge of treatment status could have influenced the reporting of subjective symptom by the patient who survived on day 7. So it is a bias because it was not a blinded trial. Now immunomodulators, these are IL-6. IL-6 considered to be a very important cytokines in the pathogenesis of COVID, responsible for cytokine storm. So we are using a recombinant humanized anti-IL-6 receptor monoclonal antibody. This receptor is going to inhibit the monoclonal antibody and block the IL-6 mediated signaling by competitively binding to both soluble and membrane-bound IL-6 receptors. the rationally I have already talked, and there are very cellular mechanism why we should use it. The doses is 8 mg/kg, maximum 800 mg at one time, given slowly in 100 ml normal saline over 1 to 2 hours. Dose can be repeated after 12 to 24 hours if required. The contraindication are known hypersensitivity, patient who have active bacterial, fungal, mycobacterial infection, hepatitis, patient who have high procalcitonin, low platelet count, have neutropenia, patients who have hepatic impairment, less than 18, more than 90, pregnant, breastfeeding, and any patients who have a diverticulitis or GI perforation history is there. The BMJ 20 January 21 have reported some tocilizumab 65 and standard of care means those who were not given tocilizumab 64 patient, total 129 patient, and in 9 hospital in Brazil. This was again an open label trial. Trial was stopped due to, this is very shocking, trial was stopped due to increased number of deaths in tocilizumab group. And trial was done on severe and critically ill patients who were definitely serious. And because of that seriousness also, they were at the risk of death. The conclusion was that use of tocilizumab versus standard of care was not superior to standard of care alone in improving the patient's clinical status at 15 days and might have increased mortality. The NEJM before that, December 2020, have more patients, that is 389 patients, and in which tocilizumab group was 249, placebo was 128, but there was no reduction in mortality, this trial showed. Now, this evidence from the recovery trial from UK-based and REMAP CAP provide consistent evidence that tocilizumab, when administered with corticosteroid, offers a modest mortality benefit in certain patients with COVID-19 who are severely ill, rapidly deteriorating with increasing oxygen needs. Means patients who are symptomatically deteriorating, their oxygen requirement increasing, their radiologically also they are worsening, and their markers are also worsening. However, the panel found that it is very challenging to define the specific subgroup of patient that would benefit from this intervention. Now, atezolizumab is an anti-CD6 monoclonal antibody. This is also because of the clinical, radiological, and oxygen requirement and marker worsening patients, it should be used. Dose is 1.6 milligram per kg IV. Subsequent dose are also used if required. There is no clinical trial. The contraindication are same because all these are monoclonal. Side effects also are there. These side effects, because this monoclonal are going to interfere with the innate immunity, and then that can trigger the hidden infection. Bevacizumab again is a recombinant monoclonal antibody against vascular endothelial growth factor. The theory is that this factor is responsible for increase in permeability of the vascular permeability, that is responsible for pulmonary edema and ARDS in the patient with COVID-19. This drug was used in acute lung injury, ALI or ARDS in COVID-19 patients. The dose is 7.5 mg per kg diluted in 100 ml in normal saline over 1 hour. There is no much data available. Then JAK inhibitors, these are baricitinib, ruxolitinib, and tofacitinib. These inhibitors are a family of intracellular non-receptor tyrosine kinase that carries the cytokine-mediated signal via JAK state pathway, but there is no clinical data. It is only expert opinion and only some small number of experience which drives this use of these molecules. Other monoclonal antibodies are bamlanivimab, which is a IgG1 monoclonal antibody directed against the spike protein of SARS. And then there is an antibody cocktail. This cocktail, caserivumab and imadivimab, these are experimental and designed to produce resistance to SARS coronavirus, and the combination of two antibodies intended to prevent the mutational escape. And this will have a very promising future if it succeeds, because then it will put a full stop or halt all the mutations and variant which has been discussed in the previous lectures and its impact. Now, today, only yesterday, the permission is given by DCGI to a molecule which is developed by DRDO. Our defense organization is also very active. They have created on a war footing various hospitals in the various states and particularly in our city of Ahmedabad. And these DRDO organization scientists have developed a glucose analog. The mechanism is that it accumulates in virally infected cells and that inhibit the virus synthesis. This is claimed to be faster recovery of hospitalized patient, reduced oxygen dependence. This is available as a sachet. There are no major side effects in clinical trial, and it is considered to be an adjunct treatment. Now, about the broad spectrum antimicrobials, this is a too busy slides, but it says that there is no evidence of co-pathogenesis of bacterial infection in COVID-19. Using the antiviral empiric is going to increase the side effect potential, and this broad spectrum antibiotic for bacterial pneumonia is moderate or severely hypoxemic patient can be used, but other experts believe that it is only for specific situation such as presence of lobar infiltrate on chest x-ray, leukocytosis, or elevated serum lactate level or microbiologic data or patient in a septic shock. Problem of validating is that gram stain culture or other testing of respiratory specimen is often not possible because of the aerosolization of the virus during this diagnostic procedure or handling of the specimen. So till date, there is no clinical data which says that empiric antimicrobial use is justified in COVID-19 management. Coming to the oxygen patients who are desaturating, for them, we have to use the oxygen therapy. It can be a low flow, high flow, or it can be a non-invasive or invasive ventilation. We have to take care of the keeping the saturation above 94%. That should be the target without causing distress and work of breathing. Work of breathing is seen by the patient's own respiratory rate, the contraction of sternomastoids and LNSE and indrawing of the intercostal space. This indicates that patient work of breathing is more. So we should keep the patient saturation at more than 94 without causing much work of breathing. And I would here like to add that whenever we use oxygen therapy, the oxygen therapy requires a flow meter to control the flow in which there is a humidifier, and this humidifier contains the water. So this humidifier bottle should be clean and preferably sterilized, and the bottle water should be changed daily. Tap water should not be used. Only RO water, because many high-end who are dealing with the moderate and severe COVID patient where dialysis is required, their RO facility is there. So either an RO or distilled water should be used, because this single measure is going to reduce probably one of the factor for causing the mucormycosis, which we have seen a spike for last 1 month. So in summary, the summary I will put in recommendation of rating scheme, where A is strongly recommended, B is moderate, C is optional, and the quality of evidence for A is at least one randomized trial without major limitation. 2A is randomized trial or subgroup analysis of randomized trial. 2B is non-randomized trial or observational cohort, and 3 is the expert opinion. So in which now the outpatient treatment, the recommendation is use one of the following combination, and these combination are granted by FDA for the monoclonal antibody to treat the outpatient with mild to moderate COVID who are at high risk of clinical progression. This is bamlanivimab 700 milligram plus etesevimab 1400 milligram. It has a higher rating, is A, and probably a superior rating for the evidence. Another one is a casirivimab 1200 milligram plus imadivimab, that is both 1200 milligram, and this also have a rating same A to A, and this is the antibody cocktail which we are talking. It should be a game changer because it is going to prevent the mutation or going to halt the mutation. So patients who are not hospitalized and mild to moderate COVID, where these therapies of monoclonal can be used, patient who are hospitalized does not require supplemental oxygen, there is no sufficient data to recommend either against or for the remdesivir use this group of patient. For the patient who are high risk of disease progression, the use of remdesivir may be appropriate. This is what the statement is. Patient who are hospitalized and require supplemental oxygen, where remdesivir or dexa plus remdesivir can be used. Patient who are hospitalized and requiring oxygen delivery through high flow or non-invasive, there dexa plus remdesivir or dexa is used. These patients can qualify for tocilizumab if they are admitted and in the ICU and rapidly worsening, and their oxygen needs is also increasing. Hospitalized patients require invasive mechanical ventilation or ECMO, where dexamethasone is the A1. But these patients who are within 24 hours, they can be given the benefit of dexamethasone plus tocilizumab. Remdesivir proof or remdesivir evidence is lacking for this group of patients. Although we have seen, as Madhav Desai sir have seen, that in the randomized trial and the control study, the experience is different and real life experience is also different. This is AIIMS ICMR COVID-19 national protocol. It is a 2-busy slide. It is just released 15 days back on 22nd April 2021. I will show you for the milder disease, means only URTI symptoms, they should be quarantined and the all attempts should be made to decrease the transmission of virus to other members of the family. In this, the tablet ivermectin 200 microgram per kg once a day for 3 days, this should be avoided in pregnant and lactating women, or tablet HCQ is given for day 400 milligram BD followed by 400 milligram OD for 4 days unless contraindicated. Plus inhalational budesonide 800 microgram is given as a dry powder inhalation or MDI at a dose of 800 microgram BD for 5 days, and to be given if the symptoms of fever and cough are persistent beyond 5 days of the disease onset. I have made this HCQ as a underline because AIIMS itself has rolled out its protocol on 3rd of May in which the HCQ is not mentioned. Now, the moderate disease, they should be admitted in the ward or in ICU. The treatment given is methylprednisolone 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg in divided dose, or equivalent dexa is 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kg, or equivalent prednisolone is 0.6 milligram per kg. This treatment is given for 5 to 10 days. Patient may be initiated or switched to oral route as and when patient is stable. Anticoagulant should be used as a prophylactic dose or in the either as an unfractionated heparin or low molecular weight heparin, depending on the availability. The enoxaparin is given as a 0.5 milligram per kg per day, that is 40 milligram subcutaneous OD. These patients should be monitored closely. These are the patients moderate who have the respiratory rate more than 20 and SpO2 less than 94, but more than 90, and severe when we call respiratory rate is more than 30. These are the severe group of patients, severe disease. This respiratory rate is more than 30, breathless, and SpO2 less than 90. In this group of patient, it is the methylprednisolone can be used, and a higher dose is 1 to 2 milligram per kg. So dexa is 0.2 to 0.4 milligram per kg. So methylprednisolone is in 2 divided doses, or dexa can be used. And this is duration is 5 to 10 days. And here intermediate dose, that is the 40 milligram BD, subcutaneous BD dose of the low molecular heparin is used. Now when to use the remdesivir, that is also there in the AIIMS protocol, that is emergency use authorization considered only in patient who have moderate to severe disease requiring supplement, no renal or hepatic dysfunction, EGFR is less than 30, hepatic enzyme should be less than 5 times. If it is more than 5 times, it is not used. It is absolute contraindicated. And those who are within 10 days of onset of symptoms, those all of us know, it is not to be used in patients who are not on oxygen support or in home care settings. Tocilizumab, again, this is labeled as an off-label. All of the below criteria are met. Presence of severe disease, so not in moderate, severe disease, preferably within 24 to 48 hours of onset of disease or for 24 to 48 hours of the ICU admission, significantly raised inflammatory marker, that is CRP and IL-6, not improving despite steroids, no active bacterial, fungal or tubercular infection, dose is lower, that is 4 to 6 milligram per kg and in 100 ml normal saline over 1 hour. Convalescent plasma is also as a off-label use only when following criteria are met, that is early moderate disease, preferably within 7 days of onset of symptom, and it should not be used after 7 days of onset of symptom. Availability of high titer donor plasma with the signal to cutoff ratio suggestive of more than 3.5 of antibody or equivalent should be preferred if it is available. Now, high risk patient is the medical comorbidity, lung, liver, heart disease, and diabetes and cerebrovascular disease, obesity, and all those more than 60 years of age. Now, this is the last slide. So what we have seen in the first wave was comprised by elderly patient, more than 60, 65 years of age, or patient were comorbidity. There were lockdowns, less number of patients we were able to handle. We started using steroids. We started using favipiravir after the June. We were using the HCQS, and we also started using tocilizumab because remdesivir was not available. Remdesivir was not even in the guidelines. Now what happens in the second wave? We have enormous, large number of patients which cannot be handled by the current healthcare system, equipments, and human resources. Most patients are young, and these patients have no comorbidity, and now we have seen with the patient's recovery, we have seen one deadly fungus, black fungus, mucormycosis increasing, which are very high, that is 30 to 50% of mortality if it is not treated, not diagnosed early, and the debridement is not done in time, and the at least a longer treatment of 6 to 8 weeks of amphotericin B, which is highly nephrotoxic and very costly, a 6,000, 7,000 odd rupees for the conventional amphotericin B. So this is the difference between the first wave and second wave. With this, I conclude my talk. Thank you very much for a patient hearing, and over to the moderators.
Thank you, Dr. Bhagira, sir, for nice and lucid presentation. It was really excellent, and you have given insights for all the drugs which are available to treat the COVID-19 infections. There are a number of the patients are there. So I would like to request Dr. Anil, sir.
Thank you, Anand bhai. First of all, let me thank both the speakers for doing a wonderful job. They have made everything so easy and so clear, because in this era of WhatsApp, we have less number of patients, we have 100 times more doctors. So it was very important to clear many misconceptions. So we will go step by step. First of all, I will concentrate on vaccine. Madhav bhai, first of all, I would like to have a social comment on you, as a community, don't you feel that we have failed actually? Because we should have motivated, government has done its job, but as a doctor, we should have done little more to, encourage our population or even our colleagues.
I would beg to differ in that sense that we have offered ourselves as the clinical trial subjects. What more do you want? See, we have taken the vaccines at a time when it was only, we have taken it in 28 days, second dose. Right,
sir,
and now they say that the second dose can be given after 6 to 8 weeks for better results. So we have already done our job. We have already represented. We have already told them that we should have gone on a war footing, in the sense like in Israel, that 24/7 vaccines would have been given. Then probably that this second wave would have not picked to a level of 4 lakhs per day. So agreed. But do you think that if the government listens to the experts, they don't have to come to the IMA for that?
Yeah. Sir,
the unfortunate part of India is that the policies are made by administrative officers, and doctors work under them. And even the guidelines, everybody who is a little bit of knowledge of COVID, they will come to know that guidelines are not exactly guidelines. They are more of convenience. So care, we should leave politics aside. My point was, even some of our friends, because I am very sure in the first wave of vaccination, not less than 40% people of our fraternity has taken vaccine. 60% of us, we were able to take vaccine. 40% of, they were waiting, which one is better? Covaxin is better, Covishield is better. So, I mean, this is ridiculous, actually. Yesterday I had one story from WhatsApp. A donkey was released by a ghost. He was tied to a tree and he was so hungry and he was thirsty also. And there were two baskets. One was having water, one was having food. So he was not able to decide. And ultimately he died, both of hunger and thirst. So that is what is happening, actually. Vaccines are available in first part. I mean, since January, government was requesting everybody, please come and take vaccine. And vaccine centers, I mean, how much vaccine has been wasted, actually? So that was a social, I mean, I am also getting every day, I am sure that everybody of you must be getting questions from everybody. Okay, sir, I am taking aspirin, where I can take vaccine. Sir, I am taking anti-diabetic medicine. Why take the vaccine? That will save you rather than those side effects which are, you have seen, I've read in WhatsApp or social media. So the clear message is, please, there is hardly any contraindication to vaccination. And whatever vaccine you can get, you should take it. There is no difference between vaccine. These are marginal differences that is not going to, I mean, in practice, they are not going to affect much. So this is my firm conviction. And I am sure that most of my colleagues, they will agree to it. Please, everyone of us should get vaccinated. So, sir,
I can only add one thing. Real contraindication to the vaccine is if you develop anaphylaxis with the first dose, don't take the second dose.
Yeah. Allergy.
That means everything. Yes. Everybody can take the vaccines except this.
Yes, sir. Very nice.
Even correct. If you have a history of allergy or anaphylaxis to other drugs, you can still take it in the presence of a hospital and when there is a facility. We have treated anaphylaxis and all of them have survived. I don't think any anaphylaxis had not survived in the presence of a doctor.
Half an hour observation period is always there in vaccination center. You have to stick to that. So the next part is that a lot of people, I have seen the question board, like they want to know more about the number of vaccines. I don't know why they are crazy about. In world, there are 10 vaccines which are now approved. They want a little bit more highlight from you, please, if you want to elaborate on that.
Basically, we can say that the vaccines can be categorized into four categories. When there is a whole virus vaccine. That is the whole spike protein or the coronavirus itself is inactivated either by way of chemicals or irradiations or the drugs. So it is made, that is our Covaxin. Covaxin is an inactivated coronavirus itself, spike protein. They extract the genetic material from the coronavirus and directly with the help of the adjuvant, algel, that is injected. So that is number one. The second is a viral vector vaccine, wherein the genetic material of the spike protein is incorporated in another viral vector, right? And there we have got these AstraZeneca or our Covishield and also these Sputnik vaccines. Both these are viral vector vaccines. In AstraZeneca or a Covishield vaccine, the viral vector is chimpanzee adenovirus. They have found out they already tried this chimpanzee adenovirus in the Ebola vaccines, AstraZeneca people, and so they selected that vehicle. So in a chimpanzee adenovirus, which has not caused disease in the human beings, that is why they selected this virus and they incorporate the genetic material into the chimpanzee adenovirus and inject it. The Sputnik people have come out with the two versions. One is the regular Sputnik 5, where there are two different dosages. This is very interesting to know. In the first dose, they give genetically modified human adenovirus that is called RAD26. And the second dose is by the second genetically modified human adenovirus that is RAD5. So if you take two dosages of the Sputnik 5 at the interval of 21 days, it's 21 days, then it is a two different vaccines or two different materials. But now the government has already given EUA permission for the Sputnik Light, which is only the first dose. Because they have found out that the first dose itself is an efficacy of around 79%. So they have given what they want, what the government wants. When there is a paucity of the dosages, it is better that we give maximum number of first dosages. If it is the efficacy up to the tune of 79%, or as we have said, the effectiveness be even 50-60%, that will make most of the people have some immunity, partial immunity, and that will reduce the burden of the cases, burden of hospitalizations in moderate to severe cases. So Sputnik vaccine is going to come next probably month, probably. So what now we have it, the Covaxin. Second one is the Covishield and the Sputnik, that is the what is available here is the viral vectors. And the third is an mRNA vaccine. mRNA is the messenger RNA vaccines, here the genetic material of the spike protein is separated out, and in Pfizer vaccine, that is the Pfizer and BioNTech vaccine, this material is synthesized in the laboratory. They don't use any viral particle. They use this genetic code sequence and incorporate it into a lipid nanoparticle, because it's a very unstable. So in a lipid nanoparticle, which itself is very unstable, and that is why it has to be kept at a minus 70 degrees centigrade. So here this virus material is incorporated, synthesized, while in Moderna, the actual viral material is used, and again it is posed in the lipid nanoparticle, that is LNP, and that is why there is a difference in the storage requirement. And both have to be used in a very short period, so they cannot be transported for a long period. That is the mRNA vaccines. The good part is the mRNA vaccine, because it is produced in the laboratory, it has a very short turnaround time. Now, if they want this UK strain or the Indian strain, they'll start doing this in the incorporate into the laboratory and start manufacturing, get the clinical trial, and maybe in another 2 months' time, they'll come out with the new versions of these mRNA vaccines. So probably future is the mRNA vaccines. And as we can see, the real world scenario also, as I saw the breakthrough infections, over 95 million in USA and only 9,000 cases, right? Out of these, I'm sure our Indian breakthrough infections are much more than that. So it has worked, it has proven beyond doubt, right? So I think mRNA vaccine is the third category. The fourth is the DNA, which our Kedila is already in the phase three clinical trials. Here it's a three dose vaccines. It has to be given. It has to be given by what is called the iontophoresis, or it is given intracellular, probably intradermal, they will be giving it. We don't have the results of the phase two, but it's supposed to be the good vaccines, and maybe itself also maybe a game changer. Then people are trying the Johnson & Johnson is the one dose vaccine. Again, they use the it's a viral vector vaccines only, and it's also the single dose vaccines. It's given for the single dose. And there is a Novavax vaccine. They use the viral like particles. The particles are separately along with the adjuvants for immune booster, because if you don't use the whole viral proteins, then it will not be that immunoreactive. That is why they have to add the adjuvants, and that is the Novavax. So these are the different types of vaccines. And within that group, there may be many more, but what we see in the near future in India will be Sputnik. And because the Pfizer's and the Moderna have also asked for the EUA, maybe in the private sectors, we may get it, maybe rolled out these vaccines.
Sir,
the Pfizer, they have conducted trials in Qatar against this B1351. And this is a variant, and they found it to be 100% effective. This is just recently I have read. Many people, they are asking about vaccines in pregnancy and lactating mothers.
Right. So there are two answers to that. First, if you go by the Ministry of Health and Welfare, it is contraindicated. But in the same paragraph, they will write that if the pregnant lady woman is at a high risk, suppose she is going to come in contact with the persons who is already in the presence of the exposed persons, they can be counseled and given the vaccines, because none of the vaccines which are available contains live antivirus. So they are not going to catch the infections or transmit the infection to the new. So I, for one, believe that vaccines can be given after counseling to the women that this is an off-label use, because it's not officially allowed, because it has not been tested in the clinical trials in this subset of population. So it remains an off-label use. But after counseling, and if there is a high risk, should be given pregnancy as well as lactating
Sir, in USA, this Moderna as well as this Pfizer vaccine, they have been allowed to be used in pregnant lady with some, obviously, some discussion and some consent or some explanation. Dhiren bhai,
they have agreed because now they got real life experience that so many of them happened to conceived and delivered, and it has been proven effective in preventing the disease. And in fact, one of the question I read was whether it passes the antibodies. Yes, it does pass the antibodies in the umbilical cord, but the levels are much less than one it's in the maternal blood.
In the same sense, just a minute. I just wanted to add, somebody have asked whether they can, vaccinated female, they can conceive. Yes, of course they can.
So as I said, in the initial part, they said that if you are planning for conception, you should not take the vaccine, because in the initial part, they were not sure about how the vaccine is going to behave. But none of the constituents are teratogenic.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Dhiren, two questions.
Yeah,
one is that if nobody has taken vaccine, and a person wants to take vaccine, and there are all vaccine available in India, like, you know, even Pfizer and everything. So what would be your choice? What would you prefer? Right? First one. And second question is that if already taken the Covishield 2 dose or something, Covaxin, then can we take another vaccine for a prevention? What is your opinion, sir?
To the first question, it will be my personal opinion that if all the vaccines are available today and I'm not vaccinated, I'll go for the mRNA vaccines. Only thing is, I have to be very sure that they have maintained the cold chain to the tune that it is potent. That question that hangs around in our country like ours, and that too in the months of May and June, probably that's a big question. The next to that, if it's available, I think Covaxin scores over the COVID, at least in the younger people. Because in the younger people, at least the younger than 30, or now they say younger than 40, there are these thrombotic complications they would come out with, even though it's a very rare. Only thing is, it is accepted now officially that there is 1 in 1 million chance of getting the thrombotic complication with the cerebral venous sinus thrombosis or mesenteric thrombosis or splanchnic thrombosis. So if I don't want to take a chance, obviously I'll go for Covaxin for that matter.
Yes.
Covaxin, another point about in favor of Covaxin is it has got the minimum side effects, except for this thrombolytic complication, which is very rare. And Covaxin, I think that way, or in variant also, as Fossey has said, it works in variants. So probably, but I will say, Dhiren bhai, don't go into this discussion at this point of time. Right now, this is no time to discuss. Whatever you are getting your hands on, please get it.
Yes, that's my first answer, that whatever is available today, I'll not wait for tomorrow. Because of this kind of second wave, I would like to be inoculated as early as possible. So the first answer is whichever is available first. But given choice, as Dr. Dhiren bhai said, ke mari paase paanche paanch saame mukhya. Obviously, I'll go for the Moderna if I'm convinced about the storage, or I'll go for Covaxin. Sputnik, well, is as good as AstraZeneca vaccines to me, because it also contains the adenovirus. And again, there are different kinds of opinion about these vaccines, because see, it has to be everything in the open domain, that all the clinical trial results in all. There have been some studies, some reports that in one of the countries, it produced a lot of common cold infections, right, after Sputnik. We don't know how much is true and how much is the speculative. But so at least Covishields, all of us have taken, and nothing of that sort of has occurred. So probably past 45, I still prefer Covishield, because Covaxin is not available. Even people who have taken the first dose, they are running here and there for the second dose of Covaxin. Right now, that is the situation in Gujarat. So,
sir, as this time in second wave, we have seen a lot of pediatric age group patients. And so pediatricians are really worried. So there are a lot of questions coming from pediatricians. They just want to know what we can do for the children, what vaccine, or whether our vaccines are available for them, and which age group we can give them, and how we can help them to face the third wave, if at all it comes. Your opinion?
One thing is that up till now, all the vaccines have been tried only up to the 18 and above. Now the mRNA vaccines have started doing it in the age group of 12. So even in the pediatric age group also, we can divide less than 10 and more than 12, right? And probably the vaccine trials are underway for the people, the children under the, before about 12 and between 12 and 18. So we'll have the answers, but the good part is that except for the rare multi-system inflammatory disease like a Kawasaki type of disease, most of the children do very well. And except paracetamol and symptomatic treatment, pediatricians don't advise anything because most of them are, they behave very well. And as I said, in my personal experience, also my granddaughter of 6 years, she tested positive for the RT-PCR, but she recovered much earlier than us. She started on third day, she was in her virtual class.
Yeah, yeah. Sir, this, and I have one information also, this Moderna has started their investigation in 6 months to 12 years.
Okay.
While rest of the vaccine, they are already conducting trials from 12 to 18, all practically, including Sputnik or Covishield or AstraZeneca, whatever it is. So they are all conducting trials between 12 to 17 or 12 to 18. But Moderna has started from 6 months to 17 years of age. Anand bhai, you want to ask some questions? Okay, so vaccine part is over. I think
I think there are a few questions that the big questions that everyone would be asking is, if somebody has developed the COVID infections after the first dose, when we should take the second dose?
Yeah, yeah.
That is, so when somebody develops infection after the first vaccine, irrespective of when was the COVID infection has occurred, we have to count the second dose after the infections. So if I have developed the infection, I develop infection 21st of April. So 2 months after that, because the second dose itself would work, COVID infection work like a booster dose for the patients.
28 days to 30 days, yes.
It's already work as a booster dose. So there will be going to be an immune response to the body over and above the first dose. So at least for 60 days, in the next 60 days, the antibodies levels will be good enough. If at all you are worried and cost is not an issue, it costs only 500 rupees, you can go for the antibody titers and then decide about it. But if you don't want to do the antibody titer, you can do it only after the 60 days. After 60 days of your tested positive. Irrespective of when you are taken the first dose.
Consensus is say 30 days to 90 days.
That's what I'm telling, but the official is after 60 days, 60 to 90 days.
Yes.
But if you are having any doubt, you can get your antibody levels before that also. And,
this antibody also not the simple one. You have to get a specific antibody done.
Yeah, so the thing is, anti-spike protein antibodies.
So there are questions about this. In some of the vaccination center, they are giving first dose as COVID shield. I don't know what is the question, what they are to ask.
So second dose has to be Covishield.
Yeah, yeah.
There are questions that Now the another question is, if you have taken one dose of Covishield and it's Covishield is not available, should we take Covaxin?
No.
Answer is no. As of now, no. In fact, now there are trials they have started, what they call it mix and match. That means they are trying parallel trials of different arms. When A vaccine is taken, first dose, the B vaccine is given the second dose. So all different vaccines are tried and a different parallel arms, and we'll have results, but that will take not less than 3 months, right?
One question is from Dr. Amit Arora, whether you, about the booster dose. Right now, we are not sure what is going to happen after 8 or 9 months.
Yeah, the answer is from the clinical trials, they have studied the antibody levels and they are analyzing the antibody levels, how they are reducing antibody levels titers. And their presumption is that it will work for anything from 6 months to 12 months or longer. So maybe after 6 months, we ourselves can get the levels. But officially, as of now, the third booster dose is right now not there. But Covaxin people have started advocating, asking for the permissions for the booster dose after 6 months.
Sir, in US, Pfizer has already started it.
Yeah, that's what Pfizer, I'm telling. But,
Anand bhai, any more questions from your side, sir? Anand sir, can you hear? Unmute, sir, unmute.
Yeah.
Please, go ahead.
So, one common question that some people are developing a COVID-like illness after first dose of the vaccination. In that case, when to give second dose? And if they develop COVID-19 after first dose, then the duration of the time for second dose?
Yeah, the second part is already answered. Right, that it is 2 months after the COVID illness and nothing to do with the interval between the infection and the first dose. That is the second part answered. The first part is, yes, we do find many persons who have been having the symptoms which could be COVID. See, it's very in a disease which is so rampant these days, and when we are getting 4 lakh cases, and that is the reported cases, so there has to be much more number of patients than then. So it could be that the patient may be in the incubation period and has taken the vaccines. So we have to watch the symptoms very carefully. And I, for one, would go for RT-PCR before labeling them as the vaccine-related symptoms, because the RT-PCR will make them COVID as a case. And in that case, they will follow all the isolations and the treatment part of it. If it is RT-PCR is negative, I would still watch that patient closely and monitor. I may repeat the RT-PCR after another 3 to 5 days, and we may go for the inflammatory markers. The vaccine would produce the influenza-like illness? No, it will produce only the headache, body ache, but it would not produce the sore throat, or it would not produce the running nose and all. If somebody level of influenza-like illness, either it is an incidental influenza-like illness or the infection by the SARS-CoV-2 virus, vaccine would not produce false positive RT-PCR. So if somebody has an RT-PCR positive, it is not vaccine, it is a disease itself.
Very important message, sir.
For Bagheera, sir, if low-grade fever passes for 9 to 10 days in young patients with normal oxygen saturation, should it be a reason to worry?
No, if the patient is a younger, no comorbidity, and fever is there for 9 days, and if we have gone for the X-ray chest, which is normal, patient saturation remains normal under monitoring, and one set of all routine investigations and markers are normal, there is no need to worry, because we haven't seen the patient going for the worsening in a delayed fashion. Patients are worsening, but they are worsening when they have moderate symptoms and they do not take the treatment, or they are not have access to the treatment, then they worsen.
I can add something to that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, what Dr. Bagheera says is correct. Two things we have to keep in mind. If patient is in many drugs, it could be a drug fever, one. And when the patient is already hospitalized or is receiving the IV drugs, we have to look for simple things like thrombophlebitis, because time and again, we see these are the causes of the low-grade fever, and unnecessarily we do battery of investigation. So look for whether there's an injection abscess or a thrombophlebitis or a drug fever, rule that out, and then only think of the progression of the disease. If you already inflamed markers, as you said, they are normal, I don't think there is a cause of concern. Agree.
Bagheera bhai, I may differ here, sir. Because my nephew, he stays in Bangalore. His family, his wife and daughter, they became RT-PCR positive. He was negative. I suggested that you are also treat yourself as a positive. So he said, no. He just took paracetamol and all that. His wife and kid became all right. On 8th, his fever persisted. On 3rd or 4th day, he started getting low-grade fever. Then fever gradually increased. Oxygen saturation went down on 9th day to 84%. Then we started looking for bed and all that. And by that time, I already started steroid. So then he was shifted to a hospital. You will be surprised. Earlier also, we did all the parameters. Everything was normal. His HRCT score was 3/25. On 10th day, 11th day, HRCT was done. Score was 16/25. His IL-6 was 300. CRP was more than 100. So it's not that key. You should not worry. Fever and one question, one important question, which I want to all panelists, with all our experience, what we are seeing is remdesivir, if it is an antiviral drug only, then it should work in early phase. But what we are seeing is, if the patient is not responding to fever, is persisting, we are admitting that patient, or the saturation is going down on 9th or 10th day, we admit the patient to the hospital, we give remdesivir, and patient improves. So I don't know whether it is really working or it is just by chance, but it has not happened in one case. It is in number of cases, actually. If you ask all your colleagues, you will find a lot of stories like that. Of but course, they are not.
Yes, sir. Here I fully agree with the story you narrated, and it is really a matter of concern. But the point is that as a clinician here, one should first know that he got his first RT-PCR only as a contact, not as a symptomatic person.
Sir, his RT-PCR was negative of 4 times.
I know. Sir, still, he was asymptomatic contact.
No, sir. He developed fever on 3rd day. And unfortunately, you will be surprised. Still, his RT-PCR is negative. So that's why in Bangalore, we rushed from pillar to post. We had to approach the health commissioner, health secretary, even the governor. And then we generated this request. This RT-PCR is not required. Because there is system in Bangalore is you have to develop some number, UI number or something like that. And without RT-PCR positive, you cannot develop that. And if you are not having that number, you cannot go to any hospital. The hospital will not touch you.
So here, this case is probably raising a question, Madhav sir. Is this what we are saying that vaccine is having the immune escape kind of things, which is a hypothesis and hopefully it should not be. All the vaccines should also cover the variants. But now is it coming to the test kit that probably a test kit is also having some escape of the...
This is there. We are having a lot of...
60 to 70% of the sensitivity is there. That means out of 10 patients, 6 or 7 would be positive even if they have classic COVID kind of things. And we have seen that RT-PCR negative and having a lesion in the HRCT thorax is around 10, 11, 12. So is it the RT-PCR is also probably requiring some change according to the change of the strain of the virus?
Yes, it is. That is what I have mentioned in the variant of concern that really it escapes the diagnostics also.
Yes,
right. This S gene, but if you look closely, if you follow, see, all laboratories do not follow the standard. Though it is a government approved, but you should go for at least 3 genes. If you go for 3 genes, which should include S gene, right? S gene, N gene. N is a nucleocapsid. If there is an infection, then N gene has to be present. So N gene, M gene, S gene, and yes, this ORF. So ORF, N gene, and S gene should be there. S gene may not be detected if there is a mutant strain, right? S gene may not be picked up, but ORF would always be positive. So just the laboratory might consider this to be the negative, right? If this tests are negative, or maybe the viral load may be not be that much. A person who is partly vaccinated, the viral load may not be that much. And that could be another reasons that sometimes we see that his test was positive at one laboratory, not on the other day, at the other laboratories. So if the cutoff is 35, somebody in one laboratory is 34, another 35, 35 will give negative, the 34 will give positive. So it happens because of this kind of, which is extremely rare, but there can be, I agree that the sensitivity with the current test would definitely go down because of the increase in the mutant strains.
I would like to add here with this discussion about this issue, that the sample was correctly taken, touching the wall of the nasopharynx.
That will also always.
And is also transported properly and handled properly and also tested properly by the laboratory, as sir is saying.
Probability will be there. Something will be there.
I know. This discussion is confirming that it is already true.
I agree. That will always be there. That will always be there. No, my question was remdesivir. Okay, how it works on 10th day, whether it works or not. Because it is, you have seen a number of cases.
See, Dr. Anil Bhai, the answer, simple answer is that remdesivir is not tested in the first week. So we don't have the data. It's tested in the hospitalized patients only. So all the data we have is only in the moderate cases, right? Who require, that's how the trial design is. Now, if today the company will start doing the trials, I agree with you that if it's an antiviral, it should be given when there is an increased viral load rather than waiting for the cytokine storm and the ARDs and everything to occur. But we don't have the data. So if you talk on the data point of view, you have to use it as
and probably it is trial. Also possible when the remdesivir trial was conducted at that time, such late presentation, persistent fever also were not there. That is why it was not designed and it was not tested in that group of patients, which we see is an aberration of the clinical presentation.
Anil bhai, with 10 day of remdesivir, I think with can you give added that time steroids?
No.
If remdesivir,
the patient is only
remdesivir,
you already added the steroid that time.
Dhiren bhai, remdesivir was started on 10 day. Yeah, because remdesivir was not available. It was steroid was started on 7th.
That is okay, but if you add already added the steroids, Maybe responded to steroids, not because of remdesivir.
No, but it has not happened in one case. Even with steroids, his fever was not going down. The moment he got remdesivir, and he said, this is Ramban. And unfortunately, you will be surprised, there were two IAS officers with whom this thing has happened. And now they believe remdesivir is the Ramban.
Ten days is the cutoff. Right after 10 days, you should not be using remdesivir.
That's what I'm saying. But it is not. They were given up to 15 days.
Yeah. Sir, 10th day is a definite cutoff. 9th day is in our ICMR
guideline.
And Ministry of Health, all put together.
Yeah. Under 10 days, they're right. Under 10 days.
Under 10 days.
If these IAS officers have convinced probably, then we should tell them to introduce the policies.
They will try. Sir, next question
Dhiren bhai, the answer to your question is that whenever a patient is desaturating, steroid should be added.
Yes, definitely.
Whether there is a timing for remdesivir is there or not, but steroids become indicated when patients start requiring oxygen. That is a time when we should add the steroid.
Bhagirath
but
bhai,
a patient came with a late cytokine, like suppose 12 or 13 days, right? And patient admitting hospital with a low saturation. So that time, can we give remdesivir or not?
As per the guideline, it cannot be given, but you will be using it.
Everybody, every one of us, frankly.
So the point is that what has happened during this time that there was a remdesivir is not available easily. So many a time when you think a remdesivir is required, you will take 3 or 4 days for its procurement only.
Maybe
the patient is on 6th, 7th day. Madhav sir, patient is within the range. Within the indication, which is advised and guided as per the government guidelines, but patient is having the remdesivir available on 10th or 11th day.
My nephew, he has got only 2 doses. After that, there was a gap of 2 days.
This is a practical question. When patient we have seen on 7th day of starting of symptom, we say the remdesivir is available, should be indicated, remdesivir should be given. Now remdesivir is available on 11th day. Are we saying, going to say no to the patient? We will not give because it is out of the guideline? Because we have already advised.
Bhagirath bhai, another question is about the use of steroid and anticoagulant. You can look around your friends, our colleagues, from day one, anybody having RT-PCR positive, they will start prescribing anticoagulant and steroid, left and right. What do you want to say to them?
Sir, on the day one or day two, for mild disease, OPD patients, they may not have symptoms.
Yes.
Mild disease and patient is having a target saturation, not desaturating, definitely. They should not be prescribed the steroid and anticoagulation unsupervised. This indication only become moderate and severe disease.
This is
agreed. I can only add one thing that steroids absolutely no role in the first week. There is beyond doubt. The anticoagulants, other day, I attended one of the symposia where Dr. Guleria clearly mentioned that the mild case in the out of hospital context, just D-dimer values has to be extremely high, more than 2000, then only you think of it, or patient has some comorbid conditions for which you might think of the thromboprophylaxis, otherwise not, right? So you should not prescribe an oral just based on D-dimer of 1000 or 1200. You should not prescribe anticoagulants in a patients who are not hospitalized, who are still in the mild categories. And we don't prescribe.
Ecosprin, they are prescribing for everybody.
Ecosprin is not required even if your D-dimer is 2000 because it's an antiplatelet drug and here it's...
No role, yes.
Yeah.
No role.
Yes. So that is about... And now coming to the TOSI. Do you feel... it has got some role or it is... Still, I have to see some usefulness of this product particularly. I have not seen a single patient in which it has worked.
It's a double-edged sword. You have to use at the right time. That's it.
When it doesn't work, everybody said right time.
No, not
sir.
That's the case. See, if you read the if you read the tocilizumab website, even simple boil is a contraindication. You might bring the patient out of the cytokine storm, but he will die of bacterial sepsis.
Practitioner, yes.
So that's my point. So you have got to be very careful about the indication as well as contraindications when you use drug like tocilizumab. It's a double-edged sword.
Sir, you remember in septicemia 20 years back, Pfizer came out with a drug C protein or something like that.
Yeah.
That was costing 5 lakh. So, yeah. I mean, every patient of sepsis was given that. And unfortunately, patient after patient kept on dying. Then they said, no, you have not used it the right way, not the right time, and the right dose. But after all, that product died. So I think the TOSI is also, people are running here and there.
Sir, in a patient-to-patient basis, probably we think that tocilizumab is working. But as far as the evidence is concerned, because on this forum, we have to talk on two fronts. Now, one is evidence, one is the personal experience. So if we talk of the evidence, tocilizumab evidence is not robust. Tocilizumab evidence is not robust. On the contrary, what I cited in one study, they have seen there is increase in mortality in tocilizumab arm compared to the standard of care arm.
Sir, some question is there that some doctors are using favipiravir for 10 to 12 days. Absolutely no. 5 days more than enough. First thing is
used up to 14 days. So in a given circumstances, I think 7 days treatment is sufficient. But what you said, like previously we have discussed, that patient is still having a low-grade fever, and we have evaluated all other causes for fever which are not there, and patient have a good saturation, and the patient is having all markers and everything normal, where I think we can continue for 14 days. Sir, Madhav, sir, you want to add anything?
Yeah, I agree fully that, see, in most of the patients, within 5 days, we will know that most of the patients otherwise also would have recovered without favipiravir. So sir, 5 days would be sufficient enough in most of the patients. If they have not recovered and if they have developed, if they continue to have symptoms, and if you are thinking of remdesivir or patient remains in the mild case, we can still use it because it has been clinically tried in up to 2 weeks. So there is no harm in giving in the patients who need it. There'll be, I think, less than 10%.
Sir, another question is, favipiravir still works? Does it work? And if it worked, then when? I mean, early phase or late phase?
Favipiravir is designed for the mild disease only.
Absolutely. I agree.
First of all, let me clear two things. One, NIH guideline or WHO guideline, it is not there.
Not there, yes.
Two, Indian guidelines, which has been rolled out on 22nd April by ICMR, AIIMS and Government of India, also favipiravir is not there. Even AIIMS also came out with its own guideline on 3rd or 5th of May, last week. Also, favipiravir is not mentioned. And I said, Dr. Shashank Joshi and his study in Journal of Infectious Disease, they have said there are 27 randomized controlled trial ongoing. So answer to the favipiravir status is still in the question. We just cannot have a foolproof answer for the favipiravir.
Sir, next question is about ivermectin.
No, before that, I'll just with the favipiravir. Yes. See, you have a lot of pressure of giving something, right? And favipiravir is not contraindicated. See, barring their contraindications of patients on repaclinide or patient that is G6PD deficiency or patients having high uric acid levels or gout or something like that, there are no contraindications to giving it. So patients having a comorbid conditions, patients who are still in the mild disease, there is no harm in giving something which is proven antiviral, at which reduces the viremia. It may not cure the disease, but reduces the viremia. Patients, because I know I have been witness to the trials which are done in the HCG hospitals, where RT-PCR became negative with the favipiravir. So we do not say that you can just outrightly reject the drug. Only thing is, it has to be used in a right number of patients. And second thing, when the RT-PCR is negative in the patient has symptoms, it is ILI. So it's a good drug for as an anti-influenza drug.
Sir,
in fact, we started with that.
Yeah, yeah. All drugs are repurposed drugs. Yeah. All drugs are repurposed. Bhagirath Bhai, yes, ivermectin. Sir. Ivermectin. Today only I read and report, or of course it was on WhatsApp, some news, article was there, ki ivermectin can prevent the third wave. So your comment, sir.
Sir, ivermectin also internationally, if you look as per the evidence is against anything. Not even SCQS also any evidence. because you see the first wave we are using HCQS, in second wave HCQS hardly anybody is talking about. So ivermectin also there is no robust evidence, but ICMR AIIMS guideline and Ministry of Health guideline, they have definitely indicated and wrote about the 200 microgram per kg of the ivermectin for 3 days in a patient with a milder disease. So ivermectin, whether it will prevent the third wave or not, that is, hopefully it should prevent, but whether it will prevent or not, only time will say.
Sir, UP and Bangladesh, ivermectin is giving just like in vitamin C to all patients, all contacts of corona disease.
For your information, sir, ivermectin clinical trials are going on in Dhaka and Lahore only. If you see, if you go to the PubMed and all, if you look into the all details, the various trials are ongoing with the ivermectin plus azithromycin, ivermectin plus HCQS and various combinations. They are all cornered around the Bangla third world countries of our neighbors like Bangladesh and Pakistan only.
Sir, if you read the wording of the guidelines for ivermectin, they neither for or against. Their very wording is neither for or against. So if you believe into
it, for everything.
So the choice is left to you. No, HCQS, that is not the case. HCQS, that's not the case. HCQS is clear and not. And I will not give HCQS without getting an ECG at least. So the question of India, not giving it on a telemedicine consultation. So
All India Institute of Medical Science, they give HCQS to all hospital employee, all personnel in All India Institute of Medical Science in first wave.
That was 2020,
Yes, sir.
Prophylaxis.
Bhagirath Bhai, we have seen number of, mucormycosis case, and nowadays it's increasing very high. So what is the real message to the physician to take care of all this to prevent the real, mucormycosis? Madhya sir also.
So first of all, mucormycosis, we should diagnose early. How to diagnose early? First is a black dot around the nares, means nose, or a blackening or a black brownish discharge coming through the nose, swelling on the cheek, or a swelling in the eyes, or patient complaining of blurring of vision or pain around the part of the face, means the over the sinuses. This probably would indicate that patient is having a something which is there, because our most of the patient are in a moderate disease. So they are sometimes not in a position to complain also, because they are having some hypoxia, oxygen is ongoing. That is the first thing. We should diagnose by imaging, that is a MRI, which is going to tell you about the extent of the disease, because it is remaining in the paranasal sinuses, maxillary sinuses, but it can be sometime found in the
orbital.
Soft palate also, and it can go up to the eyes orbit and can extend into the brain also. Then it is going to cause thrombosis of the surrounding vessels, and then it causes a necrosis, and then this process is relentlessly fasterly progressive. So that is one. KOH sampling should be sent to prove it, and amphotericin should be started, and ENT, ophthalmic surgeon or a dental surgeon, depending on the area or site of involvement, should be called. And if it is possible for them anatomically, surgically, then they should debride that part that is going to hasten the recovery, and patient should be started with the amphotericin. These are the part, and in my oxygen slide, I have shown that probably the patients who are requiring oxygen, these patients, flow meter and humidifier, the bottle which is used as a humidifier where the water is filled, these bottles should be cleaned. This water should be changed daily, and tap water should not be used, but distilled water, or if facility is there, then RO water should be used for the oxygenation.
I agree. I agree a few more things. One thing you said correctly. Second thing, we have to revise the overall treatment, and we have to look diligently for the sugars. Patient may not be diabetic, but he may have stress hyperglycemia or because of the steroids, and whether he's on steroids and what dose. So even if the patient is not diabetic and if the sugars are more than 200, I would start insulin in that patient. That's very, very important, that if you prevent the ketone formations, all this mucormycosis would not survive. So it's very important that you prevent ketosis by all means. That is one of the mechanisms of these mucormycosis. and rest you have already said, and if MRI is not possible, even CT scan can pick up.
CT scan can diagnose, yes.
Yeah. Because patient may not be moved.
Sugar tight means they targeted tight sugar control with the help of insulin is must for a good outcome of the patient. So it cornerstone is the good sugar, tight sugar control, amphotericin B and surgical debridement, and watch for the nephrotoxicity. This should be the message.
Most important issue is it should be diagnosed at the earliest. You should always be on watchful, be on guard, look for mucormycosis, especially those patients who are you are giving steroid as well as immunomodulators.
Yes.
Many general physicians, general practitioners are also starting steroid in first week. I think that should be also very
first
careful.
First day, sir, first day. And now the
that should be very careful.
Sir, this JAKs, anti-JAKs are available. Oral anti-JAKs are being used by general practitioners. Because this pharmaceutical company, they are sending WhatsApp notification to all doctors, this is drug, this drug is worked. So problem is that, sir. Over usage of drugs is probably one of the reasons.
Sir, I would like to add one thing that steroid, say in a WhatsApp university, there is a lot of kind of prescriptions or moving on, in which some write azithromycin, ivermectin, doxycycline, antihistaminics, and the
Montelukast
and paracetamol and mucinec and all. But we will not be able to justify these or not. But if it is steroid is as a part of this, then it is definitely not justified and it should be removed immediately. Whenever any person contact me and they send me that this is a list of drug we have started, and then I inquire to them and I tell them, "Not, please stop the steroid. You continue everything. You monitor your saturation. Moment your saturation drops, you consult your doctor or you visit to a hospital, you start the oxygen, and that is the time when steroid to be started."
Bagheera,
so steroid is a part of this.
Yes.
Bagheera,
another question is that people are asking, when the studies were with the dexamethasone, Why are we fascinated by methylprednisolone? Because dexamethasone is cheaper, easy to give. In every way, it is superior. Why everybody is using any benefit? I mean, everybody is asking why there is there any benefit of using methylprednisolone, which is a costlier drug, high doses, and I mean it's not easy to give. Because normal dose.
Point is that methylprednisolone is an intermediate acting steroid. Dexamethasone is a longer acting steroid. Dexamethasone will have a lowest sodium and water retention compared to the methylprednisolone. But if we look to the effect which starts, means onset of action, would be faster with methylprednisolone because it is intermediate acting. So it will have a faster onset of action. It is more pure and it is not a prodrug. It is a drug which is acting inside our cell. So
and even the concentration in the lung is better with methylprednisolone.
Better. So that is why methylprednisolone would be equivalent choice to dexamethasone. Of course, it is still a costly drug, but I would say if one has to choose between dexa and methylprednisolone, one should choose methylprednisolone because it will give a faster onset of action.
Good, good. This point should be clear because everybody is asking studies was with the dexamethasone and it's such a cheap drug. Now 6 mg dexona is also available. So can be given easily. But I think if the patient is very mild, then you can use dexamethasone. If it is moderate.
No, sir. Mild disease. If we talk of mild disease,
those who are having fallen saturation, but other parameters are maintained. They are requiring only oxygen. You don't need any other thing.
See, they are equivalently working. This is just like you said about the vaccine, which you will choose. Otherwise, if you dexamethasone also is equivalently going to be helpful as an anti-inflammatory. But okay, the only problem with the steroid early use, why we discourage, because giving the steroid early, it is an immunosuppressant. It suppresses the immunity at various levels, pan immunosuppressant you can say. So it interferes with the body's innate immune response to fight against the virus. And early use of steroid is going to increase the viral replication. Because you are suppressing the innate immunity of the person who is receiving the steroid, where the steroid is not indicated. And you see, out of all medication, the positive evidence is with steroid only, not with any other drug. Any other drug you see, they say may be used, may not be used, RCTs are ongoing, we are collecting the data, but for steroid, there is a definite data.
Sir, the antibody cocktail,
Yes.
This is, this has been approved.
Approved, yes.
Emergency approval, and the Trump was treated with that only.
Yeah.
So, anything else want to add?
No. Even I have also a question, because in this antibody cocktail has been used for a milder disease, and this cocktail is promising for the prevention of mutation also. So that way also it will prove game changer. But the only point that it has been emergency use authorization by FDA is given to the patient who are likely to progress. So there we have to probably draw a line that when you are dealing with a milder case, how to decide where this patient is going to progress, whether it is based on the monitoring of temperature and oxygen, whether it is based on the other biomarker parameters, or whether it is based on the radiological parameters. So this probably is not mentioned in that, but it is clearly written that it should be given in only to the patient who are likely to progress, or it should be given only to the patients who have already having a comorbidity with a milder disease. So we these things are not clear for the antibody cocktail.
So I think the discussion has been very, very fruitful and very engaging. I hope we all have got, lot of education and lot of enrichment in academics. So if there is no more question, then
can I add one thing?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Anil, sir.
Yes. Take home message from both the speakers.
Yeah.
Take home message, yes, sir.
Yeah. One thing is that the SARS-CoV-2 is going to stay here, and we'll have many more versions of it. So it's better that we insist for vaccinations to one and all, and we continue the COVID appropriate behavior for one and all. That's very important. We should not shy away when somebody is moving around our in the clinic without mask. We must tell them that no, you have to either you get out or put the mask. So masking and double masking if required, and vaccinations are must. That is what I'll say. And if the booster comes, we have to take the boosters also. There is no question about it.
Bagirath bhai.
I'll say that whenever we come across with a patient with fever and the influenza-like symptoms, or a patient who is becoming breathless, we should try to segregate the patient in mild, moderate, and severe and critical disease. Mild disease, we have already discussed at length that they should be treated at home only, and there should not be any panic starting of steroids. We have already discussed at length. Moderate and severe disease, when they desaturate, moderate will be admitted in the ward or HDU if they have a comorbidity. And the patient who have a severe disease or critical disease will go to ICU. Moderate disease patient, we will start them with the dexamethasone when they are desaturating and remdesivir. Severe patient also, we can have the same thing. And critically patients, actually, the guidelines are not saying silent about the use of the remdesivir, but we are not left with the any other agent. So we should start with the remdesivir, steroids, and tocilizumab.
Immunomodulator.
And when serious patient, they are desaturating, becoming critical, then we should think of the immunomodulator. So that should be the way of dealing with the COVID. But prevention is better than the cure. So what sir said, vaccination and mask, social distancing, hand wash, sanitization. So prevention is best than the disease to treat.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Both of you. One thing I will request. Sir, you want to say something?
Yeah. This is nothing to do with the acute COVID, but recently, Yes, I'll just, Ketan, 1 minute. I'll take 1 minute. Recently, I came across one patient who had COVID before, exactly before 3 months. And she came with very non-specific symptoms, complaints. And I incidentally got an EC changes of RBTP. So I thought that's probably I'm something dealing with some cardiac abnormality. So I sent to the cardiologist. The cardiologist said that we have to do troponin and maybe tomorrow we'll have to go for the angiography. I sent all the blood investigations. And to my surprise, her blood sugar came to 800. And she had no symptoms. She had no symptoms. Even retrospectively, when asked, she said that she had mild thirst. That's it. We repeated it in the laboratory. We went for the HbA1c. It was 16. I have seen for the first time 16 HbA1c. And her documented HbA1c was less than 7 before 3 months. And she was not, she did receive steroids, but for her allergic asthmatic bronchitis, not for COVID. And we admitted her. We started with the standard treatment of the hyperosmolar. Acetone was negative. And she became, she required insulin, but I saw her before a week and her live, except the Lantus insulin, she's otherwise fine. So I have, in CME India, I presented this as a happy hyperglycemia because she had no symptoms. So we have to be on lookout for this kind of like hypoxia in long COVID. We might be looking for happy hyperglycemia too, or a silent hyper. There is nothing happy about it.
We have also received.
Bhagirath bhai, there has been a question from somebody who just want to know the role of sepsivac. I don't know what is that.
No. Sepsivac is also under the role of sepsivac is only under clinical trial. If you are doing a clinical trial, if you are enrolling the patient in the clinical trial, and if the patient is fulfilling the inclusion exclusion criteria, then and then sepsivac.
Sir, what is sepsivac? I am ignorant about that. I don't know what it is.
It's a drug by the Cadila Pharmaceuticals, not Zydus one, the other one, Cadila one. And it has been available earlier as my MVACI. It was available that. And it's basically an immunoregulator.
Oh.
It's neither produce immunosuppressant, not immunostimulator. It's an immunoregulator, they say. And they have tried in Chandigarh, PGI Chandigarh, and found good results, but they did not go for the large scale trials. It's still available.
They have something like that in tuberculosis also.
Yeah, that MVACI.
Is that the same drug?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Repurposed.
So,
the new name.
Ketan bhai, please take over and.
Sir, before. Minute of condolence.
Yeah.
Sir, before that, our GMC observer is there. Just make her online and if you want to say anything about.
Yes. Madam.
Hello. Excellent presentation and excellent question answer from your side, as if you are totally ignorant about this COVID.
We tried to cover everything. Thank you.
From question answer to discussion, everything. Excellent presentation. Thank you, madam.
For being there. Ketan bhai, please take over.
Hello.
We should have a 1 minute.
Yes. Yes.
Silence.
Hello. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Hello. From the behalf of APG, I am thankful to all viewer, our president, Dr. Dhiren bhai, Anil bhai, Anand bhai, and our both speaker, Dr. Bhagirath bhai and Dr. Mahadev bhai. They have given very beautiful and very fantastic knowledge for us. And we will convey the message to all our physician and for this pandemic. Now we will also give our condolence to our president, Dr. Dhiren bhai's mother. They have lost before few days. We'll give
Om from the
APG. Then we will continue this same seminar on the next feature. Thank you.
And lastly, I request all my physicians and doctors friends, please take care yourself and your family. Don't take this disease lightly. This is my humble request. Please take care.
Okay.
So much, sir. On behalf of Medical Learning Hub, I would like to thank all the panelists or the host panelists, the moderators and the speakers, and also observers for such an amazing, knowledgeable session. I am sure all the participants and all of the panelists also have learned a lot during this session. Thank you all so much. For all the participants, I would like to tell them that we have raised another poll, that is the end poll. So I would like them to please take this poll and give us their valuable feedback. The recording of this webinar will be available in the next couple of days, and all the registered participants will be the emailers will be sent intimating them about the same. We will be here for a few more moments for all the participants to take the poll. If the panelists want to leave, they can. We will be here until the poll ends. Thank you so much.
About certificates.
Yes, and certificates will also be sent once, we collect all the data, and then we get the certificates distributed.
Sir Bhagirath Bhai.
Yes, sir.
Let us have 1 minute of silence to all of our physician friends, which we have lost recently.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. Om Shanti. Om Shanti.
Om Shanti.
Om Shanti. Om Shanti. Om Shanti. Take care.
All stay safe and healthy. Thank you, all of you. It has Thank been you. A pleasure. Enjoyed okay. this. Thank okay. you.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Okay.
I request all the participants to please take the poll. We will be here for a couple of more minutes.
We have recorded this session and the recording will be available in few days. Also, the certificates we will provide you in next around 10 days, you will receive the certifications for the same. So we will be here for couple of minutes to receive the poll and then we will end the session. So we have received the polls. Thank you so much for attending it. Keep yourself tuned and for more information, please surf Medical Learning Hub website for more updates and more upcoming CMEs. Till the time, take care. Thank you. Stay safe.
Thank you. Stay safe.
पहले लैपटॉप चला देता नहीं तो वो सुतल रहे तो धार पर उठ लेते कि नहीं वीडियो रहते नहीं तो देखा देते